I became interested in this topic because I've been interested in children's claims of memories and children's development for a very long time. And I became interested in reincarnation memories of children when I became a philosophy major and was interested in the intersection of the philosophy of religion and social science. And I, in particular, became very interested in the work of two psychiatrists at the University of Virginia, Ian Stevenson and Jim Tucker. They had conducted research and compiled a database of over 2,500 cases where children claimed to have memories of reincarnation across several countries. And it surprised me that two of the countries in which the claims of memories were the most common turned out to be India and the United States. And I thought that those countries were worth examining because in India there's a pervasive belief in reincarnation, and in the United States there's not so much. And another thing was that the social science research that Ian Stevenson and Jim Tucker conducted turned out to be very controversial because people interpreted it as trying to find evidence for reincarnation. However, some people took it seriously, including scientists like Carl Sagan. So there were, as I found, notable similarities and differences between children's testimony in both India and the United States. And my question was, how do these so-called memories shape the way that these children perceive themselves in both India and the United States? And what implications does it have across disciplines, including for the philosophy of religion? So two of the most famous cases that I looked at were those of an American child named James Leininger and those of an Indian child named Shanti Devi. Both of these were very famous and publicized cases, and they're the central focus of the article that I'm writing about this topic. James Leininger was a three-year-old child who claimed to be, from three to age seven, a World War II veteran named James Hudson. Apparently, he had some very very lurid memories of having died in World War II. And as it happened, he happened to convince the sister of James Hudson that he was the reincarnation of her brother. So I found that the memories of James Leininger happened to have a profound impact on how he perceived himself, in that he did not accept his identity as James Leininger and as the son of his parents. He believed that he was completely James Hudson for a very long time until he started to lose his memories at age seven. Then Anne Hudson, James Hudson's sister, gave him a lot of James Hudson's property, including his old army uniforms and his on some of the toy airplanes that he got, because she believed that there was some sort of kinship between them. So even as James Hudson grew up and developed, he maintained the sense of kinship with Anne Hudson. Then Shanti Devi, the case in India, was interesting in some similar and different ways. I found that in North India in particular, the parents responded very differently to her because of the pervasive belief in reincarnation. Unlike James Leininger's parents, they did not react with skepticism. They believed what she said, but were dismissive because apparently there's a belief in that part of India that having memories of reincarnation is bad luck. So, however, Shanti Devi persisted, and she happened to meet her, meet the family that she had claimed to have in her supposed previous life, and managed to convince them as well. And so she maintained a long-term kinship with that family throughout her life. So I'm going to show a brief section of a video of about Shanti Devi, because this case happened to be very famous.
Thousands of tales of reincarnation exist in India.
It's a bit sensationalized.
On the 11th of December 1926,
a girl is born in reincarnation is real.
For Hindus, she was to become living proof of their beliefs. Her name was Shanti Devi. Until the age of 4, she never spoke. When she did, her first words were explosive. She told her mother that her home was not in Delhi, but in a town called Matra, 140 kilometers away. She had lived there in her past life. Her name was Lugdi, and her husband was a man called Kiranat Chobe. Shanti was able to describe the town in astonishing detail, even though she had never been there. She could even remember how she died, giving birth to her son 7 years earlier. For 2 years,
so again, this is a sensationalized account of what happened, but it was a publicized case.
Her mother decided she could no longer ignore her daughter's
In fact, the Indian government, along with Mohandas Gandhi, had launched an investigation of this case.
So
and it did cause some
religious
action
in
India at that time. Because a lot of religious minorities believed that it was designed to confirm the pervasive beliefs of the Hindus in India.
His wife Lugdi had died in childbirth the year before Shanti Devi was born. His name was Kiranat Chobe. Was Shanti his wife reborn?
So, eventually, Shanti Devi did meet this Kedarnath Chobe and the brothers and other relatives of this man, and happened to convince them that she was the reincarnation of this deceased woman. And throughout her life, Shanti Devi continued to believe, atypical of most of these cases, that she was that woman. And so she never married, believing always that she was the wife of this man. So I found that that there were some interesting commonalities and differences between the cases in the United States and India, in that both whenever these children alleged to have these so-called memories, they strained their relationships with their real parents and maintained long-term kinship structures with the people of the deceased. They the United States in the United States, a lot of these, the details of these allegations were a lot less easily verified, while in India it was easier for both Jim Tucker and Ian Stevenson to verify them. And we believe it's because the pervasive belief in India allows these sort of these cases to happen more frequently. And as I said before, most of these children lose their memories as they age, but maintain these types of kinship structures. And I continue to maintain an interest in this subject as I completed this project. And I think that the methodology is still limited because of language barriers in the interviews conducted. But I think that it warrants more investigation from an interdisciplinary standpoint.